So the first session today is titled Computational Thinking, Assessment and Implementation. As I mentioned yesterday, computational thinking being an optional subject, often it gets rejected out when other subjects get higher priority in the curriculum. And so we are going to listen to three teachers who have successfully managed to implement computational thinking in the curriculum. And this is going to be run like a panel discussion. And to moderate this panel discussion, we will have my colleague Ramanujam from Institute of Mathematical Sciences. Ramanujam, as many of you know, was a keynote speaker in CTIS last year. And he has a long record of science popularization work through his Tamil Nadu Science Forum and through two science magazines, Jantar Mantar and Tule. And early this year, he won Indira Gandhi Prize for science popularization. And he was also influential in incorporating CT curriculum in Tamil Nadu State Board math curriculum through his work in the curriculum committee. So without any further delay, over to Jam.
Thank you. Thank you, Venkatesh. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, yeah. Very good. Yeah. So welcome you all to this panel discussion on computational thinking, implementation and assessment. We have three speakers on the panel. Malarvi from, who's a teacher in Chennai High School at the Greater Chennai Corporation. And then we have Sabita Vinod. She's from the Resource Center at the Mege Group of Schools. I think MGS needs no introduction to this CS Pathshala to CTIS. Yesterday we had teachers from Mege Group of Schools making presentations. We also have Susanna Sunil from Global Public School, Kochi. And before I hand it over to the panelists to make presentations, I just want to make a couple of remarks on the theme of our panel. Yesterday we heard a lot about computational thinking and its importance, for one thing, and the fact that the country is more or less waking up to wanting computational thinking in school education. Now, on one hand, we want it. Sridhar made it clear that we don't quite know what it is. We are still discovering. And then in terms of perception out there as to what it is, maybe this group here in CTIS and CS Pathshala have a kind of crusading attitude to take computational thinking to schools. But how do schools perceive it? How do teachers perceive it? What is the place for computational thinking in the curriculum? Ultimately, what is there in curriculum, syllabus, textbooks? They all help, but ultimately what matters is what happens in the classroom. So how does it actually take place or not in the classroom? What are the challenges involved? And is what happens in the classroom really what we mean by computational thinking? And you know, that's something that we have to be very alive to. We talk about devising algorithms, following algorithms, but following algorithms, does it give insight to devising algorithms? Doing different kinds of counting, does it actually help in computational thinking? So these are things that we cannot be too dogmatic about. We have to actually look at what happens in the classroom and what are the challenges involved. How do we assess the computational thinking curriculum itself? How do you assess what's happening in the classroom? So these are many of the issues involved. And we have some really experienced people on the panel to take these issues. First, we have Malarvi coming. She has played a very important role in a large-scale experiment in computational thinking, which is ongoing. The state of Tamil Nadu recently, in the last 2 years, has gone through a fairly elaborate curricular and syllabus reform at school level. And one of the things that was done in Tamil Nadu was replace it for classes 1 to 8, replace the earlier track, which was called data handling, by a track called information processing, kind of a generalization of that. But in what it actually amounts to is broadly what would be called the problem-solving part of the problem-solving and data organization part of the kind of curriculum and computational thinking that people have to do. So in classes 1 to 8, new textbooks have this, and Malarvili was one of the persons instrumental in devising these chapters in for classes 6 to 8, the upper primary level. So she's going to come and tell us about the experiences in devising textbooks of this kind in a broad CT curriculum within mathematics in Tamil Nadu. And then we have Sabita Vinod talking to us about what are the challenges in integrating CT into curriculum in a school. And in a school which usually starts with teaching computer, right? From teaching computers to teaching computational thinking, what are the challenges involved? What are the various steps? How mega group of schools took it up and met the challenge. Then we have Susanna Sunil coming in from Kochi Global School, coming and really talking about, okay, there is a gap between what we intend, the intended curriculum for computational thinking, and what is actually happening. Where is the bottleneck? Is there a bottleneck, the textbooks or worksheets or teachers' understanding? What are the challenges involved? How important is it for administration to understand these differences? So several practical aspects of this also. So the plan that we have is that we have short presentations by panelists, roughly about 7 to 8 minutes per person. 7 minutes is what we plan for. And after that, the floor will be open for everyone to participate in the discussion, and the panelists will come back with comments. So this is the structure of the discussion today. I welcome you all again to the panel, and we will start with Malarvili's presentation.
Hi, I'm Malarvili, mathematics teacher, Greater Chennai Corporation from Tamil Nadu. Here, I would like to share with you my involvement in writing a new track called Information Processing for upper primary level, which brings computational thinking into school mathematics as the part of Tamil Nadu textbook team. Every good book is a good friend to each student. Accordingly, our new chapter Information Processing is also much important as traditional chapters like number system, algebra, ratio and proportions, geometry, measurement, and data handling. In our old syllabus, we had data handling as one component, and it had some interesting computational thinking in primary schools. And from upper primary onwards, we had only statistics, which had mean, median, mode, etc. In the new curriculum in 2018, a new track called Information Processing was introduced for classes 1 to 8, which has new topics that shows here for your concern. All of these chapters gives a wide knowledge about computational thinking. Moreover, a strong foundation for computational thinking will be essential for children growing up in this century. As it happens, such understanding and thinking lies squarely within realm of mathematics in school. As in the slide, each of these teams offers a range of activities and educational opportunities across these stages. This slide shows the computational thinking concepts at primary level. At upper primary level, we have systematic listing, completion and counting. In this concept, the children will be able to formulate problems in a way that enable us to use a computer, which improves capability of students. And also, it helps us to create larger shapes using dominoes by logically organizing and analyzing data. In modeling, the children will be able to identify, analyze and implement all possible solutions with the goal of achieving the most efficient and effective combinations of resources they have. And this is what we need, and this makes the difference in learning mathematics. Similarly, we have iterative patterns and processes, which makes them to identify relationship between the two variables in pattern and get familiarized the types of patterns in Pascal's triangle also, in which children will be able to represent data through abstractions such as models and simulations. And we have something called following and devising algorithms. Here, they will be able to create and use their flowcharts. And also, they will be able to do automative solutions through algorithmic thinking. From now on, I want to share something with you how our new textbook specially designed for. In Mathematics Alive, children will be able to understand how mathematics is experienced everywhere in nature and real life. We are happy that the children will be able to observe the Fibonacci patterns in physical and biological phenomena in class 8. And this is an example for that. And we have something called Do You Know? Here, we gave them more additional information related to the topic and to create much more interest to the subject. For example, we should make them understand mathematics is also behind the password we are using in our mobile phone. Certainly, every child should be aware of this. Similarly, we have another feature called Think, which induces them into a deep, critical and creative thinking. Here, we have concepts like set game through which they will be able to understand the actual concepts behind the sets instead of reading the definition alone. And we have another segment called Note to know about the important facts and concepts behind the chapters or topics, whatever they are reading in. And we have more interesting concepts like activity to enjoy learning mathematics by doing it practically. For example, in class 8, working in the priceless activity, the children will be able to know, consider the alternatives before making a purchase and to calculate the unit price for each items and make purchase within their limited budget. So, all these concepts together will help our children to do mathematics in a better way. Obviously, we are sure and confident about that they will understand computational thinking in proper way. Similarly, one more unit called Try This to help them more with the interesting questions to enhance the reinforcement about the content they have learned already. For example, a simple Sudoku puzzle will help him to think more and more. Before I conclude my presentation, I wish to share with you our teacher's thoughts about computational thinking. Because of these enormous changes that have been introduced in our new textbook, we are facing many challenges to implement computational thinking concepts to the students. Even though in a new textbook training, many teachers actually participated and many of them feels very happy that now mathematics is no more imaginary. They can make feel the children that mathematics can be felt like every other subjects. And they also feel that we can make a child to know mathematics not only through textbook but also through the various practical experiences that they will be facing in day-to-day life. And we are sure about that we can make children to interact with us about the concepts without any fear. Finally, I am extending my gratitude for all the people behind this team. Especially, I have to thank my mentor, Dr. Ramanujam, our Tamil Nadu Government Educational Department TNSERT, and Greater Chennai Corporation giving me this golden opportunity to explore this new concept, computational thinking, through our information processing track. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Malar. That was a brilliant presentation. We should really express our appreciation to Tamil Nadu SERT team for taking such a bold step, because we've been talking about CT curriculum, but for a state board with thousands of schools and teachers to plunge into this with at primary and upper primary level, and it's been a remarkable experience. Yeah. Now we continue with Sabita Binu. Yeah. Yes, Malar, you want to? Yeah. So then we continue with Sabita Binu. Sabita?
Hey, Jan. Is my presentation visible?
Not yet.
Is it okay now?
No, we are not seeing.
Okay. Just a
Sabita, are you sharing screen?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is my Thank you, Jam. Malar, addition of CT as a lesson in middle school was quite interesting. I think my queries can wait for the panel discussion. Good afternoon to one and all. Coding, which is much sought out topic in the present day, is actually a language of creativity. And all our children deserve a chance to become creators rather than just becoming consumers of computer science. With this underlying statement, I will continue my panel discussion on integration of CT with information, technology, and mathematics. I'm Sabita Vinod. I'm Sabita from Mega Group of Schools, Nagpur. We are the pioneer schools in Vidarbha to integrate computational thinking in IT and in mathematics in our curriculum. One of the schools, I suppose, in Maharashtra that who have integrated in both the subjects, IT and mathematics. In continuation with what Professor had mentioned yesterday, Mr. Sridhar Iyer, regarding the curriculum of IT, we have no specific textbook or no specific framework for the IT curriculum in schools. So the contents are mostly market-driven and the skills emphasis only on usage of tools. So thus hampering the understanding of problem and designing solution. Actually, we lack an integrated approach in our textbooks. So the meeting in 2017 with the CS Pathshala team marked the beginning of a magnificent journey where computational thinking lessons were introduced as a project, pilot project for 3 months in IT and in mathematics. After the pilot project, we added it in our curriculum for both mathematics and in IT, and we have completed 2 successful years. We are in our 3rd year now with the integration in primary and middle school. In mathematics, CT lessons were blended with textbook topics in primary level and introduced as an extended activity in middle school. In primary, lessons like shapes and patterns, factors, etc., were integrated with the CT lessons. But the interesting aspect over here was the interlinking or integrating it with the arithmetic operators like multiplication and division, a glimpse of which our teachers had shared in the presentation last evening. The approach towards how do you do the long division, multiplication, etc. had changed in our children. In middle school level, it was conducted as an extended activity and lessons from IPP, systematic counting, etc. were taken up. Coming to integration with IT, adoption of CT curriculum in primary level was not that difficult compared to the middle school because for standard 1, 2, and 3, we did not have a prescribed textbook. But in the higher classes, yes, we had a little bit of an issue. So we took up lessons, IPP, systematic listening, counting, and reasoning, etc., directly in standard 1, 2, and 3. And from standard 4 onwards, we replaced application software lessons along with the CT lessons. And also in the textbook, the topics like Scratch, algorithm, flowchart, etc., we interlinked it with the CT curriculum. So the implementation of CS Pathshala actually set the gateway to a new curriculum, which was framed with CT as its epicenter. So the new curriculum was designed under these five broad headers of digital literacy, computational thinking, application of learning, integration with curricular subjects, and digital citizenship. So a brief overview of our new curriculum, which we had framed, which is called CT in IT, that is Computational Thinking in Information Technology. We extended the CT lessons up to standard 9. So we had it till grade 8, but then now we have it from grade 1 to grade 9. We came up with teacher resource material for the teachers, which had the CS Pathshala curriculum, the lesson plan, the presentation, the worksheet, etc. in it. Also, to help our students, we took up the worksheets directly from the CS Pathshala curriculum and added in a pre-printed booklet. The last one, or the most important one, is we are coming up with our own in-house textbook for standards 6 to 10, which will have the lessons from CS Pathshala curriculum. This is a sample teacher resource material from grade 1. The first picture shows the lesson plan displayed is on a simple concept of direction from CT. And this is supplemented with the G-Compress activity in the lesson plan, also in the resource material. And you can see the image over here, which actually supplements what was taught in the direction, which is helping FLIRB to move around. And to reinforce it, we have added that in our worksheet also. So these are the sample worksheets, which also includes the digital citizenship, which we have added from standard 3 onwards. We grow when we face challenges. So during the initial days when CT was introduced as a pilot project, there was a bit of apprehension as the concept and the approach of CS Pathshala curriculum was different. But with regular trainings and support, the required confidence was gained by our teachers. The other challenge which we had overcome was the teacher's preparation for classes. Actually, the previous slide, we have explained how we came up with the teacher resource material, which had the complete content of the CS Pathshala curriculum to help our teachers. And on the student front, what we found was there was no reinforcement of the topic, as they do not have a material or something, because in IT, we have only 2 periods in a week. So by the time they come back to the next period, they forget it. So we came up with this pre-printed worksheet, which we took up from the CS Pathshala curriculum. As the title goes, teachers are our strength, and trainings and feedback are the backbone of NGS. So few of our HODs and teachers have become master trainers who are now able to train other teachers in their respective schools. Because as I mentioned, we have about 14 schools across Vidarbha. The Megate CTIS was another feather in our cap, where we had about 39 paper presenters, out of which 3 press papers was taken up for this national conference, and our teachers had presented it yesterday. We had about more than 100 participants in this particular conference. From the total lessons we had adopted from CS Pathshala, 54% of these content were taken up for CT in IT curriculum and 46% in mathematics. Also, our aim being coding without computer, because we wanted a strong foundation for our children to become creators rather than just consumers. You can just see on the screen that 63% of the CT curriculum does not require a device, whereas 37% is taken up for programming like Scratch and Python. Just as an overview of how we have distributed the periods across the year from standard 1 to 8, a total of 295 periods were given for the CT curriculum across these grades. While we did overcome some challenges, there are some unmet. The first one being the integration in mathematics for high school. See, the topics of CT are different from the maths curriculum, and we all know that the syllabus of mathematics in the middle and high school is quite vast. So we couldn't find a space to fit in more of it. The next one was improving the pedagogical capabilities of our teachers. Though our teachers undergo training, almost all the lessons of what we have taken up from the CS Pathshala curriculum, but there is always a scope for the improvement in the delivery of the content. You know, as teachers, it's normal tendency that we keep correcting the students when they are solving a puzzle or something. But once we start doing it, we actually hinder the creativity. We need to allow the students to go or flow with their thoughts. So that's something which we all need to work on. Next one is the assessment of CT as a skill, which is really a challenge and still we are trying to work out. Though CT has been a part of our assessment in the form of MCQs, however, we need to find a more holistic way of assessing these skills. The last but not the least and the most important of all is integrating CT across subjects like science, social studies, and languages. We all want our children to solve problems and become critical thinkers. And for that, we need to have an integrated and a holistic approach. To summarize in a nutshell, our aim of having or integrating CT is to basically move students from merely technology literate to using computational thinking to become problem solvers and be able to represent knowledge. With this, I'd like to thank CS Pathshala and our management. Without both the support, we wouldn't have achieved till what we have achieved today, but a long way to go for us. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Sabita, for a very nice presentation and elucidating the most important aspects of implementing CT curriculum. Thank you very much. We'll get back to more of these during the discussion phase. I'm sure many people have questions. We now move to Susanna Sunil of Global Public School, Kochi. And she took up some very specific questions to discuss because, you know, the really problematic aspects of CT curriculum implementation. Looking forward to Susanna. Yes.
Hello, everybody. Good afternoon, Jam, and everybody. And thank you, Sitjis, for giving me this opportunity. I've been listening to Janet yesterday, as well as to Malar and Sabita today. Thank you. That was brilliant. The first question that Jam asked me was that, you know, or that we were discussing, is there a gap between the aims of CT? Let me talk about my experience. Like first time when we were, when I attended my computing class long ago, actually, my computer faculty asked us a question, you know, how do you eat a watermelon? And, you know, we are all smart alecs and, you know, rolling up our eyes and wanting to get our hands on the computers. And they said, what kind of a question is that? But she perseveres. And then we have to say, okay, I'll cut the watermelon, I'll take out the seeds, I'll scoop out the fruit. And then she says, yes. That is exactly what computing is about. Or that is exactly what you do, take a big problem and break it up into smaller, manageable pieces. And then refine the solution. Where would you put the seeds? How would you present it? How would you place it? What would you cut it? After all these years, that one concept sticks in my mind. That computational thinking is about breaking large problems into smaller solutions, finding out for each of those bit problems, finding out what are the resources, how do you find a solution, and keep on optimizing it till you find something which uses all resources well and is elegant in design. Now, coming back to your question, Jam, about is there a gap? Definitely there is a gap. Because first of all, the concept of computational thinking has to be clear as to why am I teaching this. So if I were to say there are three reasons I would put it down to, the first one I would say is the classroom dynamics. In our classrooms, most of the time, we have only time to teach, ask for a response, and every response must, you know, fit into the same box. I mean, everybody must give the same answer. There is no time for the teacher or for the taught, you know, to frame the problem by itself, to have multiple approaches to the same problem. You're answering a question, that's rote learning. No, what is the capital of India? Delhi. I mean, that's just a rote answer. But are you thinking of what to mean by capital? You know, how are you going behind? So there's no time for that. The second thing I find is the creativity of it. Like when I'm teaching computation, imagine a young class, you know, third standard, second standard, and I go into class and I say, imagine a pink elephant, and everybody is boom, thinking of pink elephants. They got pink elephant in their mind. I say, ma'am, this is going to happen, that's going to happen. I ask them another question, okay, what would you do if you're the ruler of the land? And they will say, okay, I will do this, I will do that. But as a teacher, let's say a computational thinking teacher or a computer teacher goes into class and says, I'm going to teach you computational thinking and we're going to do sorting. I don't want to be that student, right? I don't want to be in that class. I want to be the student touching the computers. So there is a creativity that when we teach computational thinking, we as teachers must find out, how can I make this very interesting? The recent series CS Pathshala has evolved so much. I mean, there is a lot of interesting concepts in that which we find very interesting. The third reason I feel is that the word computational in computational thinking itself. For many people, the moment you hear computational thinking, and I'm sure many teachers listening in also, and many, you know, people listening, computational teaching must be taught only by computer teachers or by maths teachers. No, why? Computational thinking is everything we do. How do I come to school in the morning? Or it could be from a child's point of view, how do I fit the 10 minutes of playing into, you know, my homework time? You know, how do I convince my mother to go in for, you know, to allow me to go for a field trip? So you have to think of, you know, the larger problem, break it up into smaller pieces. So computational thinking, I heard Janet Wing yesterday, and what a profound presentation yesterday. She could relate computational thinking in physics, maths, history, archaeology. It is mind-blowing. So that is, for me also, I agree with that totally, that computational thinking must come out of maths classes, must come out of computer classes. It must be taught as a way of thinking. How would a child approach a problem? So that is my first answer to you. The second thing that we were discussing and that, you know, we were talking about is that, what is the bottleneck in implementing? Is it the material? Is it the worksheets? Or is it the teacher? For me, the bottleneck in implementing a computational thinking class effectively is all three. If you see what Malar and Sabita put up, there's so much of detailing in those worksheets. So if that worksheet is not developed properly, it's of no use. But over and above that, even after all these work, and if you saw Sabita specifically, she said, okay, GCOM, there's a specific instruction to teachers saying, GCOMPRESS example would come here. This is the activity to do. But if the teacher doesn't fundamentally understand that computational thinking has to be taught not as a subject, you know, but as a concept by itself. I'll tell you an example. We teach Sudoku. Sudoku is one of the most interesting things that children like in the computer CS Pathshala series. We teach them Sudoku. We teach them, and the teachers love to teach. The children love to learn it. But after that, you ask the child, what did you learn? I learned Sudoku. That's the question. But did you learn sorting? Did you think of pattern matching? Would you take Sudoku out of Sudoku? Would you be able to apply it in your life anywhere else? I don't think the teacher has voiced that question to them, because the teacher herself has not, himself would not have understood that. So teachers must understand the context, I think, from where this, this concept is coming, and not restrict to, I'm a computer teacher, I can teach only computers. No, that's not what it is. So I think we must do that. We must every teacher, not just a computer teacher or math teacher, every teacher must relate. In 2018, we did a very interesting experiment. We teach grade two, I think. We teach them shapes and paints, and then that's how the CS Pathshala, we were using that series. And then we taught them what is shapes, colors, paints, and then we gave them MS Paint and GCOMPRESS or whatever to learn that to do that in the labs. And then we went one step further. We introduced them to an artist called as Piet Mondrian, and we showed her how does he include, in his artwork. And then we let them loose in the foyer in the campus. And they would come up and say, ma'am, we saw your sofa is purple and white. And, you know, that is the Piet Mondrian style, you know, and there are shapes and colors. And ma'am, this ma'am's dress is like that. That ma'am's purse is like that. And it was an aha moment for us also as teachers, you know, to see that they could bring the learning out of the class. And I'm sure now that children must be in fourth or fifth, and today also if I were to ask them shapes and lines, they started to observe things. And I think every teacher's heart feels better when that application of it happens. So that is why I like to, you know, CST should be compulsory. Another fundamental question that Jam asked, and I agree, is that, you know, how important is for school admins to understand the difference between teaching computers to children and computational thinking? Very, very, very important. All school admins must understand, and it must be drilled down, that computational thinking is so different. The concept itself is different. It cannot remain only in the computer room. At Global Public School here, our management allows us so much of freeway. You know, we are able to do so much of innovativeness because we are able to bring that in. And it's not just the management. For me, I feel, Jam, is that it's not just admins. It's every teacher must own that concept. That when I teach history, when I say 1497 or 1487 Vasco da Gama, or I say 1757 Battle of Plassey, 1857 Indian Mutiny, I mean, you know, when you're talking history, can I bring that concept alive? It's not just teaching dates, you know, of people long gone and dead. It's about making it, how was the battle plan? What kind of warfare was this? What kind of artillery? What kind of strategy was this? That is where computational thinking will come alive. And
we are losing your...
We must. Yeah, okay. I think we must do that also. You know, we must bring that it's not just admins. I feel, Jam, we must... Every teacher must own the space. And I think, like, that's what... So for me working here, you have to have the latitude. You have to have the breathing space to define new things. And that's what our school offers. And CTIS also gives us that platform to come back and tell them that this is not right. You know, so I think wonderful. I mean, I'm honored to be here and privileged to be here, Jam, and to all of you all, and to the entire CTIS team. Thank you. Thanks a lot. You're doing a wonderful job. Thank you.
All the brilliant panelists very interesting presentations. Important matters have been spelled out by the panelists. I thank them. And there have been several questions that people have been posing. I want to pick out a few. One of the things is that question, which is really important for implementation, and this was asked by Jayashree Pai. And she's asking, how important are textbooks and how important are worksheets? Here is one question for you to think about. I would like the panelists to come back to this. Another question. This is from, let's see, Soumya Srivastava, who's asking, what should be the order for teaching CT? I mean, in some sense, we have said the systematic counting, pattern recognition, decomposition, and so on. But would you prioritize them? Which comes earlier, pattern recognition or decomposition, for instance? So I want to take up these questions for discussion before we move on to others. Would any of you have something to say on this? I see Sabita starting.
Yeah. Yeah, with the question on whether require a textbook or a worksheet, it all depends upon how our approach is, because the CS Pathshala curriculum itself is so well designed with the flow, right? So as I mentioned earlier in my presentation also, it is so clear, but then we need to have an approach which, like what Susanna had mentioned, an holistic approach, and the teacher needs to understand how to deliver it. Right. So we require a textbook because you need to have the contents. So when we say about a textbook, it need not be the same history geography book what we are talking about. A proper flow of contents, okay, with the minute details, okay. Along with that, it is not sufficient giving the handbook or anything. The teacher, as Susanna mentioned, need to be aware how the concept has been put forth or the delivery has to be done. As we said, we can't teach, I'm going to teach computational thinking today and this is sorting. No. It has to be rendered in such a way that the child is doing something at the same time is able to replicate whatever he or she's done in the classroom. That one example was when these things were taught in the CS classes, CT classroom, regarding sorting and patterns. The child was able to connect, though it took us 2 years, we are still in the prelim, we won't say we have done or come a long way. But we have observed at least few students were able to take it up in the maths class saying that, ma'am, this was done in that period. Is it not a pattern? So it takes time. Nothing happens overnight, changes doesn't happen. It takes some time because teacher's adjustment was important. Plus for the students also to take up something different from the traditional way of teaching was there. But to reinforce it, we need a worksheet.
Malar, would you like to say something on the textbooks? Oh, sorry, I thought. Sorry, I thought.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Students are very interesting to do these activities in our classroom, sir. They are very much interested.
Okay.
Jam, if I can add to that, if she's
able. Yes, please. Yes.
Yeah. What I find in the CS Paathshala at the bottom of the page, there is something called as broadcast. That means there is something for the message for the teacher saying that what is being taught. You know, you tell the child that this is what is taught to you. So that, I think, helps the teacher to, focus. So you teach Sudoku, but at the end, what are the concepts that you are trying to teach, whether it's decomposition or pattern matching? Now, the next question that you had asked was whether pattern matching should come first or decomposition should come first. I think you have to look at the cohort of students. And see what is it. I think decomposition for me would, for me personally, decomposition works better because unless you break the problem, how can you find the problem? Okay, so that's my answer.
I completely agree that there are no general recipes. But one thing is that there is a comfort in textbook, right? I mean, it's, and also certain order of things, because what you need is a framework from which you start. I mean, freedom is also very hard to deal with in a classroom at an everyday level. I mean, it's wonderful to have a lot of freedom to do what you want, but it's also very hard to deal with on an everyday repetitive basis. So that way, textbooks are wonderful because they give you scaffolding. And certain order, suggested order of doing things works very well. Unfortunately, our classrooms have the problem that the tyranny of the textbook starts dominating the entire classroom. And that's something that we need to avoid. And this is something not specific to computational thinking or, all levels of education, whether it's school education or a university classroom, has the same problem. We are used to the textbook being a dominant voice and we want to break that. Computational thinking being new is an opportunity where we want to utilize the opportunities for thinking across the curriculum, looking at curricular opportunities and use all these opportunities. And we are making a beginning in that. There are some other questions that I want to bring up. Here is one where this is Nirupama Mahapatra Das, who's asking, somebody else also asked this, how should CBSE take it up, for instance? If you're a teacher in a CBSE school, I mean, we don't have the freedom of what Sabita is talking about, or Susanna is talking about. Malarvili is already talking about state board schools, right? The state board has The CRT has taken a decision, state board has printed these textbooks. Now CBC doesn't have anything right now. How do I take it up and what should I do?
Can I take that? Nirupama, the thing is that CBIC is taking it up. If you see the new NEP policy that's coming up, your competency-based teaching is coming up, problem solving is coming up. All that is nothing but CT. And all teachers are compulsorily have to do through Diksha. They have to do a module. Now, you will find that slow and steady, like we have started around 5 years, 4 years back with CS Pathshala, whatever we're teaching in computing is becoming mainstream. So CBSE is taking that up. Now, how would you as a teacher change it? You have to look at your whole year's curriculum. Let's say, I do not know what teacher you are. If you are, let's say, a math teacher or a science teacher, look at the whole curriculum and say, what am I as a teacher doing? Am I teaching facts, which anyway the child can refer through Google? Or am I teaching understanding? If I have time, I mean, Jam, can I elaborate on that?
Maybe we can come back to it.
So that's what. So I think you look at the concept as CBSE gives you latitude. It's not about just teaching questions, wrote notes and routing it out. I think you CBSE has implementing a lot of things. Please do attend all their, use the Diksha portal. They teach you a lot of things.
In fact, I see these questions as questions for all of us to react, not only in such panels, but you know, write articles and post them on CS Pathshala site for teachers to make use of. I mean, that's really what I think that teacher is asking for. Right? Mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. not one line answers, but detailed concept maps and so on. I want to move on to another extremely interesting question. This is from Dr. Ram Mohan Singh, who I presume is a medical doctor. It's great to have such participants here. He asks, completely radical thing. And he says, shouldn't the school start with the digital data of the students on posture and other health issues? You know, just simply take the data of height and weight and any other digital health data of the students and analyze it in class. As I said, I think it's a beautiful idea because it's a great way for students to learn about their own and its data organization. Can I just add on to it, Jam? Yeah, Sabita.
What yes. Dr. Ram had, had mentioned is absolutely right, because that is the one part of an activity which we have taken up in the curriculum where they have the weight. It is taken once a year. And in mathematics class, they analyze the weight. So that what he is mentioning, digital data, we just take it up, but not as since what he is mentioned. But then, yes, it has been taken up as a part of information processing, where they are able to see the whole class weight and height and see the differences. So, yes, it is at a preliminary stage we have started off, but that's a very good thing, which though we are revamping certain things in our curriculum, these things will be added up in the future part, in mathematics, actually.
Anybody else wants to say something?
No, I absolutely agree. That's a very good idea. And especially when you're teaching graphs, I think that could be, you know, it could personally touch the student, you know, they'll be able to work on it. Okay.
Malar, you want to react to that? Or?
It's already in our textbook. Third standard onwards, they analyze their data on height of the children or weight of the children. They analyze and put it in order how they can arrange, how they can sort out. All of them, they do some activities in this thing.
That's so why I asked. I know it's there.
We have in our textbook.
Yeah. Here is another question from Mr. Gajanan Mang. And he says, and I want to start with Malar, so because the question specifically says, how about teaching CT through activity-based learning? He has some experience himself on this that he's referring to, but Tamil Nadu has had an extensive, a few years of experience on formally bringing what it's called ABL, activity-based learning in schools. So Malar, what is your reaction to this? How can ABL kind of techniques and CT be integrated?
ABL is a card, sir. It's activity cards that students can do the activities one by one. If one children finish one card, after that only they go to the other stage, next stage to the card. From that primary classes, they do these activities from first standard level also. From it. Each and every child to finish that activity only, next slide they have to go. Next level they have to finish. Every child should complete the activities in that card. So they are able to do all the activities. When they finish only they do the next activity. So they completely know what the activities, what is going, what is that. That's it.
There are more questions, but I'm afraid not going to take them up. But I do request the participants to continue the conversation. CS Pathshala has a very active teachers portal where many, many teachers discuss, contribute. I welcome everyone to join and take up these. There are also breakout rooms at 5 o'clock, the Chai Pe Charcha that Shanti and Sonia talked about. So we will have more opportunities to continue the discussion, and specifically the questions that are on the stack right now, we will come to them in the breakout rooms. Please come and join. And same to the panelists also. I know you are dying to make more remarks that I didn't let you speak, but in the breakout rooms, we will have time for that. I want to wrap this up. It's almost time for us by making a couple of more remarks that we did not really take up. And that's the issue of assessment. Only because we had enough to talk about on implementation and things. Now, we all know that almost everything in school education and university education in India, you know, is sacrificed at the altar of assessment. You can have any number. I mean, I've been part of curricular reforms. I mean, you can have any number of curricular reforms. You can have sterling textbooks, but ultimately it is exams that rule. So, and on computational thinking, I'm afraid we are not even at the dawn. We are nowhere near understanding the issues of assessment, what assessment of learning means, assessment for learning means, and when you have technology coming in, what is assessment of technology, the use of tools. So, it's okay that we didn't have big discussion in the panel, but this is something that hopefully we'll have a long discussion, a lot of experiments, many different assessment models coming up during the years, and CTIS will become a very important and worthwhile platform for textbook writers, educators, curriculum designers, teachers, schools to reflect on assessment issues, assessment of, as I said, not assessment of children. In fact, I didn't even mention that. I'm really talking about assessment of curriculum, assessment of what we are doing, and whether what we are doing is the right thing at all. And assessment of children can wait. I think, unfortunately for us, school education invariably translates to, or even university education, translates only into certification and assessment of the learner. But we need to go further, think a lot about this. The new policy and a new education, new curricula are wonderful opportunities for that. I hope we will have a lot more of these discussions going on, and probably, hopefully, we will all be contributing to something that promises to be nothing less than a revolution in ways of doing in education in schools. Thank you all for participating. Thank you all for exciting.
Thanks a lot, Sam, for having us here.
Thank you very much.